All right, guys, let's pick back up, bottom of page 64. We're going to try and make it through the end of the chapter. The priesthood of Christ is typified by the Old Testament high priest, by Aaron, and by Melchizedek. This extended field of typology is set forth in its antitypical meaning in the letter to the Hebrews. In his high priestly service, Christ is over the hierarchy of priests which constitutes the church and as the appointer to and director of their service. In his Aaronic ministry, Christ offered a sacrifice to God. That sacrifice was himself, offered without spot. In this understanding, he was both sacrificer and sacrifice. But the Aaronic pattern could go no further than to be the sacrificer. In his Melchizedek priesthood, he is king priest. Melchizedek was of Salem, which is peace. He had no beginning or end of days, no human parents, and he was a high priest by divine authority. The Christian is a king priest unto God. His service as king is deferred until the coming age when he reigns with Christ. But his priestly service is in force at the present time. There is a future aspect of the believer's priesthood as declared in Revelation 26, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Israel was first appointed to a similar position, but in this they failed. The present king priest position of the church, being sustained by God, cannot fail. In the Old Testament order, the priesthood was a hierarchy over the nation, and in their service they were under the authority of the high priest. In the New Testament order, every believer is a priest unto God, and the whole ministering company of New Testament priests is under the authority of Christ, who is the true high priest, of whom all other priests were but types. Therefore, according to the New Testament order, service is committed to all believers alike, and on the ground of their priestly relation to God. As there was no evangel to be preached to the nations of the earth, service in the period covered by the Old Testament consisted only in the performance by the priests of the divinely appointed ritual in the tabernacle or temple. In contrast to this, the New Testament priestly ministry is much broader in its scope. Not only a service to God and fellow believers, but to all men everywhere. The service of sacrifice. At this point, there is a strikingly similarity to be observed. The Old Testament priest was sanctified or set apart both by the fact that he was born into the priestly family of Levi and by the fact that he, with due ceremony, was inducted into the priestly office, which appointment continued so long as he lived. Likewise, at the beginning of his ministry, he was ceremonially cleansed by a once-for-all bathing. In fulfilling the antitype, the believer priest is holy and once-for-all cleansed at the moment he is saved, and by virtue of his salvation is set apart unto God. So to all this, it is particularly required of the New Testament priest that he shall willingly dedicate himself to God. Concerning his self-dedication, we read, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. The phrase, the mercies of God, refers to the great facts of salvation which have been set forth in the preceding chapters of the book of Romans, into which mercies every believer enters the moment he is saved. While the presentation of the body as a living sacrifice is the self-dedication to the will of God of all that the believer is and has, that which is thus yielded, God accepts and places where he wills in the field of service. According to the scriptures, this divine act of accepting and placing is consecration. Therefore, the believer priest may dedicate himself, but never consecrates himself to God. In connection with the divine act of consecration, it should be observed that the present work of Christ as high priest, appointing, directing, and administering the service of believers, fulfills that which was typified by the ministry of the Old Testament priest in the consecration of the sons of Levi. Having yielded to God and being no longer conformed to this world, the believer priest will experience a transfigured life by the power of the indwelling Spirit, and by that power he will make full proof of what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. According to the New Testament order, priestly service and sacrifice towards God is threefold. The dedication of self, which is declared to be a reasonable service, or more literally, a spiritual worship. As Christ himself was both sacrificer and a sacrifice, so the believer may glorify God by the offering of his whole body as a living sacrifice to God. The sacrifice of the lips, which is the voice of praise and is to be offered continually, and the sacrifice of substance. Referring to the cleansing of the priest, it should be noted again that the Old Testament priest, upon entering his holy office, was once for all cleansed by a whole bathing, which bathing was administered to him by another. However, afterwards, though thus wholly bathed, he was required to be cleansed repeatedly by a partial bathing at the brazen laver, and this before undertaking any and every priestly service. In fulfilling the typical significance of this, the New Testament priest, though wholly cleansed and forgiven when saved, is at all times required to confess every known sin in order that he may be cleansed and qualified for fellowship with God. As the appointment of the Old Testament priest was for life, so the New Testament priest is a priest unto God forever. The service of worship. As worship was a part of the service of every priest of the old order, so every believer is now appointed to worship. In like manner, as the furnishings of the holy place symbolize the worship of the priest in the Old Testament order, and every feature and furnishing of that place spoke of Christ, so the believer's worship is by and through Christ alone. Again, in service unto God, the believer's worship may be the offering of oneself to God. The ascribing of praise and thanksgiving to God from the heart, or the sacrificial gifts that are offered to him. In connection with the worship of the Old Testament priests, there were two prohibitions recorded, and these also are of typical meaning. Note, strange incense was to be burned, which speaks typically of mere formality in service towards God, and no strange fire was allowed, which symbolizes the substitution of fleshly emotions in our service for true devotion to Christ by the Spirit, or the love of lesser things to the exclusion of the love for Christ. The service of intercession. As the prophet is God's representative sent to the people, so the priest is the people's representative dispatched to God. And since priesthood is a divine appointment, the necessary access to God is always provided. However, no priest of the old dispensation was permitted to enter the Holy of Holies other than the high priest, but he once a year on the ground of sacrificial blood. As for this dispensation, in addition to the fact that Christ as a high priest has with his own blood now entered into the heavenly sanctuary and is now interceding for his own who are in the world. When Christ died, the veil of the temple was rent, which signifies that the way into the holiest was now open, not to the world, but to all who come unto God, on the ground of the shed blood of Christ. Having unhindered access to God on the ground of the blood of Christ, the New Testament priest is thus privileged to minister in intercession. The contribution which is made to the doctrine of the church by the figure of the high priest and the kingdom of priests is that in this life, the believer is not only closely associated with Christ positionally, being in him, but is closely associated in those activities which he is undertaking on the plane of infinity and which may be extended by his grace to the finite sphere. As has been seen, these activities are service, sacrifice, and intercession. Again, it is made clear that it is given to the members of his body to share in the great achievement of the outcalling and perfecting of the Church of Christ. The Savior has a glory which accrues to him because of his great accomplishment, but his own are who are in the world are his instruments who will share with him in his merited glory. Theirs is not merely a glory which is a benefaction, but is one which is due to partnership fruition. Section 5 of this chapter, the head and the body with its many members. In contrast to Israel, which nation was an organization or commonwealth, and in contrast to the visible church, which is merely a human systemization, the true church is an organism. The term organism indicates that the thing specified is permeated throughout all its parts with one common life. It is the same life in the roots and the upper structure of a tree. It is the same life which is in every member of a human body. Similarly, it is the same life that is in the church. Each individual that the company has not been only baptized into one body, but has been made to drink into one spirit. The figure of the head in the body is, with its many members, is employed in the sacred text more than any other and serves to indicate certain essential facts representing the church. Namely, that the church is a self-developing body, and that the members of this body are appointed to specific service, and that the body is one. Section 1. The church, a self-developing body. The central text bearing upon this aspect of the activity of those who comprise the church is Ephesians 4:11 through 16. In this passage, following the enumeration of ministry gifts in this age of the church, namely apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, the writer declares that the ministry of these gifted men, especially the pastor and teacher, is for the perfecting of the saints unto their work of the ministry. In this age, and in no other, there is a specific message to be preached to every creature, and while there are no leadership men who are God's gift to the church, the obligation to witness rests upon every Christian alike. Too much recognition cannot be given to the accounted multitudes of faithful witnesses who are discharging their commissions as Sunday school teachers, mission workers, personal soul winners, and living exponents of divine grace. This is the God-appointed New Testament evangelism. The latent evangelizing forces of a congregation of believers are beyond all human calculation, but they need to be trained for their task. And God has prescribed definitely that they should be trained. How else would they be accurate and skillful even in their limited sphere of service? That they are to be trained is indicated in Ephesians 4:11 through 12. The revelation here is not only of the fact that the saints have a witnessing service to perform, but also of the fact that they are to be equipped for this service by the gifted men whom God has placed over them as their leaders. The word keroproes, here translated perfecting, is a noun which is but once used in the New Testament and means equipment, and so refers to that preparation which all saints should have that they may be effective witnesses for Christ. The verb form of this word is found elsewhere in the New Testament and with significant meaning. According to this passage, the pastor and teacher is responsible for the equipment of those given into his care. Although this equipment does involve methods of work, it includes much more, namely, an accurate knowledge of the truth. But the pastor and teacher must be trained for his leadership task. Under existing conditions, this preparation is committed to the professors in the theological seminary. Their responsibility is greater than that of other men, inasmuch as the heavenly things transcend the things of earth. Observe this stream flowing forth from its source. Whatever truth and ideals the professor imparts to the students in training, they in turn will later impart to the larger groups over which they are given spiritual care. If a congregation is not actively engaged in soul winning and missionary work, it is usually because of the fact that they have been deprived of the God-intended leadership to that end. If the pastor has no soul-winning passion, no missionary vision, is limited in his proficiency, and inaccurate as an exponent of the Word of God, his lack in these respects may generally be traced to the fact that he has been deprived of the God-intended spiritual and vital training in the seminary. It may therefore be restated that the responsibility of the seminary professor is no less than superhuman. If this be true, no man is fitted to render faculty service in a seminary who is not himself awake to his responsibility and, in addition to that advanced training and accuracy in the truth which his position demands, is himself a worthy example of missionary zeal, evangelistic passion, and tireless soul-winning effort. What revival fires would be set burning and spiritual forces be released should the church demand the purification and perfection of her fountain sources of doctrinal teaching, as well as the worthy illustration of spiritual vitality and soul-winning passion in the life and ministry of those who mold the character of her God-appointed leaders. This is not an appeal for the lowering of worthy scholarship. the all-too-prevalent notion that scholarship and spiritual passion cannot exist together in one person was forever answered at the beginning of the Christian era in the case of the Apostle Paul. To say nothing of thousands of great preachers of the past who have attained to inviolable scholarship without restricting their spiritual lives or restraining their passion of soul. The objective in this general witnessing on the part of the whole company of believers is to accomplish a specific task in a prescribed time, till we all come in the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. The perfect man here cited is not to be interpreted to mean perfect men. It is the completion of the body of Christ by adding thereto of all who are his elect people in this age. The dangers which beset believers who are deprived of the teaching, the teaching that which was referred to in the previous verse is described in verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Over against this, the one who is taught will hold the truth in love. The word in verse 15 translated speaking is better rendered holding. The truth is to be held as a controlling possession. Such a one will grow up into Christ in all things. To conclude this statement respecting the development of the body of Christ, the apostle writes, from whom the whole body fitted together and connected by every joint of supply according to the working in its measure of each one part works for itself the increase of the body to itself building up in love. From the above, it will be seen that the church, like the human body, is self-developing. Her members, as evangelizing agencies, are appointed to secure other members. Intelligent soul-winning service on the part of Christians is the New Testament expectation. Section 2, the members are appointed to the specific service. This extensive portion of truth, which likens the Christian to a member in the human body and with a special function to perform, is centered in 1 Corinthians 12. And these functions represent the exercise of spiritual gifts. The context continues through chapters 13 and 14. A similar and exceedingly important passage respecting the members of the body and their service is found in Romans 12, 3 through 8. Yet again, contributing a vital part to the general doctrine of the gifts which the members of the body exhibit is 1 Peter 4, 7 through 11. It is to be seen also that the entire theme of the baptism with the Spirit and that which it accomplishes is closely related to the figure in question, since it is by that baptism that each individual becomes a member in Christ's body and thus is joined to Christ. It is in 1 Corinthians 12:12 that the unity of the body in its revelation to the head is stated. The passage declares, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so is Christ. In this connection, it will be remembered that in Ephesians 4:4, the apostle makes uncomplicated avertment. There is one body, and it is in 1 Corinthians 12:13 that he defines the manner in which members are joined to Christ. He states, for by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. All believers are of the one body. Now you are the body of Christ and members in particular, for we are members of this body, of his flesh, and of his bones. The possibility that through human weaknesses there may be jealousy and strife between the members of the body is guarded against by first pointing out that each member of the body is placed where he is in the sovereign will of God. Of this sovereignty, the apostle writes in strong statements, dividing to every man, dividing to every man severely as he will. But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him. Likewise, in Romans 12:3, the same sovereign purpose is recognized with respect to those gifts which are manifestations of the specific activity of each individual member in the body. It is written, for I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. When dealing with jealousies and strife, the apostle reminds the members of Christ's body that the honor before God is the same, whether the position in the body may be same, whatever the position in the body may be, or whatever human ideals may suggest. All members are necessary, and all will be equally rewarded according to their fruitfulness. Section 3, the body is one. The extent of this theme is to be seen in the fact that it forms the very framework upon which the highest revelation respecting the church is fashioned, that set forth in the letter to the Ephesians, the argument relative to the one body, after the introduction of the theme in chapter 1, begins in chapter 2. It is defined in chapter 3, is enforced in chapter 4, and concluded in chapter 5. In chapter 1, the direct statement is made that the ascended Savior is head over the church, and that the church is the fullness, completion in respect to desire, of him that filleth all in all. The passage declares, and has put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that fills all in all. Chapter 2 is largely the discourse of the fact that though there was in all generations so great a difference between Jew and Gentile, the bringing of Jew and Gentile into one body has broken down within the church wherein they are united. The middle wall of partition that separated them and destroyed the enmity. After 1900 years in which the privileges that constitute the distinction between Gentile and Jew have been divinely set aside, it is difficult in the present time for one to realize the difference which prevailed between those two people at the beginning of the present age. Two underlining facts should be observed. First, God, while not releasing his power and sovereignty over the nations, had nevertheless declared his favor toward Israel alone, which people formed the acknowledged heritage of God. True, it was a welcome accorded to strangers who chose to ally themselves with Israel, but all were strangers who were not of Israel. There was no other nation or people who were the chosen of Jehovah, to whom he was married, whom alone he knew from among the families of the earth, and whom he had redeemed from Egypt by both blood and by power. Probably no passage of Scripture describes the peculiar estate of Israel before God more completely than Romans 9, 4-5. It is written, "Who are Israelites to whom pertaineth the adoption, and the glory, and the covenants, and the giving of the law, and the service of God, and the promises? Who are the fathers, and of whom, as concerning the flesh, Christ came? Who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen." Certainly, Israel would have been reprehensible had she failed to acknowledge or respond to this divine election. However, the distinction was national and provided no basis for that Pharisaism which came to prevail in the attitude of the Jews towards individual Gentiles. Secondly, the prejudice of the Jew towards the Gentile, based upon divine favor, had come to be nothing less than hatred and contempt. To the Jew, the Gentile was a dog, and it was contrary to custom for a Jew to keep company with a Gentile, let alone enter his house. Only a divine command could persuade Peter to enter the house of Cornelius in Acts 10:20. Probably no other scripture describes the actual estate of the Gentile before God more completely than Ephesians 2:12. While the lost estate of the individual has been disclosed in verses 1 through 3 of this chapter, the national position of the Gentile, which was equally true of the individual, is described in verse 12. Again, it is written that at the time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. Five disqualifying charges are here preferred. The Gentiles were without Christ, not only personally Christless, as all unsaved are, but having no national messianic hope. They were outside Israel's one divinely recognized commonwealth. They were strangers from the covenants of promise. This does not deny that God had predicted great earthly blessings for the Gentiles in the coming kingdom age. It asserts rather that he had entered into no covenant with them as he had with Israel. The Gentiles had no hope, since no covenant promise had been accorded to them, and they were without God in the world. So they could make no claim to his purpose or favor, and they formed that portion of humanity which was under the curse and was doomed to destruction. The world today knows little of the godless and hopeless condition of human life among the Gentiles in the days to which reference is made. It is said that at the highest state of Greek culture under Alexander the Great, it was commonly held that the best thing was not to be born at all, and next to that was to die. So fully did the experience of the human heart reflect the actual relation with which it unknowingly sustained to God. In the midst of these distinctions between Jew and Gentile, which were set up by God, owed of God, and accentuated by human prejudice and hatred, a new divine purpose was introduced, made possible on the ground of the death and resurrection of Christ, and the advent of the Spirit on the day of Pentecost. That divine purpose is no less than the forming of a new body of heavenly people drawn from both Jews and Gentiles, each individual in that body perfected in Christ, and the whole company destined to be to the praise of the glory of his grace. Therefore, because it is to the glory of his grace, each individual in this company, whether Jew or Gentile, is called and saved upon that distinct principle of selection, the sovereign grace of God, apart from all human merit. As a basis for this exercise of sovereign grace, apart from human merit, the most startling divine decree was announced, startling indeed, because never before heard of in the world, and because it is so contrary to the hitherto divinely sanctioned exaltation of Israel over the Gentiles. That decree declares that now there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. They are all under sin. So again, there is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. There was little for the Gentile to unlearn in connection with this new age purpose and plan of salvation. He had no ground for hope before, and the gospel of salvation by grace became to him as life from the dead. But the Jew stumbled over the way of salvation through the cross, and only a few, though their national preference is set aside for this age, have been able to abandon their assumed national standing with God and to accept the exceeding grace of God in Christ. By the words, but now, at the beginning of 2:13, I believe of Romans 11, 2-13, yeah, a sharp contrast is drawn between the former estate of these Ephesian Gentiles, okay, so probably Ephesians 2:13, of these Ephesian Gentiles described in verse 12, and their new position in Christ. Here they are told that they, as Gentiles, who were at a previous time far off from God, were henceforth, because of their new position in Christ, made nigh, not by external ordinances or human virtue, but by the blood of Christ. To be nigh to God is one of the exalted positions unto which each believer is brought at the moment he is saved. The perfection of this position is seen from the fact that one cannot be nearer to God in time or eternity than when he is in Christ. So perfect is the efficiency of God, of the blood of Christ, in providing a righteous ground for divine grace, that every desire on the part of God, though prompted by infinite love, can now be satisfied completely on behalf of those who believe on Christ. Verse 13 is closely related to verse 17. In the former, only Gentiles are in view, but in the latter, both Jews and Gentiles are seen. The Gentiles are identified as those who, because of no former covenant relation to God, were far off, while the Jews, because of their covenants, were nigh, but not nigh to the same degree in which the saved Jew and the saved Gentile are now, being in Christ and redeemed through his precious blood. In verse 14, Christ is declared to be our peace, and to have broken down the middle wall of partition between Gentile and Jew. The wall of separation, here said to be broken down, was set up by divine arrangement at the time when God entered into covenant relation with Abraham. But now a new thing is introduced, new as a declared testimony and actual undertaking, but in purpose and promise it is older than the created universe. By saving both Jew and Gentile alike upon the same condition and into the same heavenly glory, Christ becomes in the fullest sense their peace, and by recognizing both to God, becomes thereby the most effective of reconciling agencies. Every distinction is lost in this glorious oneness in Christ. Neither Jew nor Gentile can rightfully claim superiority over the other, since they are both perfected forever in Christ. So likewise, in addition to the fact that Christ establishes perfect peace between the Jew and Gentiles, they being united to him by faith, he breaks down the middle wall of partition between them. The revelation that Jews were under divine legislation not imposed on Gentiles, a fact typified by the wall with which separation of the court of the Gentiles in the temple from the restricted area reserved only for the Jews occurred, became a wall of separation between these two classes of people. By the death of Christ, the wall was broken down. The Gentile was not elevated to the level of Jewish privilege, but the Jew was lowered to the level of the hopeless Gentile, from which position either Jew or Gentile might be saved through grace alone into a heavenly position and glory. In his flesh, Christ abolished the enmity, even the law of the commandments, and every aspect of law which might seem to provide, because of its meritorious character, a basis for man's responsibility to God, thus placing the child of God, whether Jew or Gentile, upon a new obligation, one of not striving to establish merit, but rather of living in all devotion to him whose perfected merit is vouchsafed to all who believe. This new obligation is elsewhere termed the law of Christ. The removal of both the enmity and the partition between Jew and Gentile is divinely accomplished through the creation of one new man, not by renewing individual men, but by forming one new body, the church, of which Christ is the head. Thus, in the church, he reconciles both Jew and Gentile unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, separated as they were by the different relationships they sustained to God. It is through Christ that both Jew and Gentile have access by one Spirit unto the Father. This declaration provides indisputable evidence that believers now have peace. And how marvelous is that peace when it is the portion of those who were not only at enmity among themselves with a divinely established partition dividing them, but who were enemies of God. Chapter 3 of Ephesians defines the church as a sacred secret, hitherto unrevealed, which provides for the forming of a new body by making Gentiles fellow heirs and of the same body, and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. There is no ground for contention about whether the promise in Christ by the gospel is a note never before sounded. It is as new to Jew as it is to Gentile. According to verse 5, this Pauline revelation is the unfolding of a mystery or sacred secret, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. No better definition of a New Testament mystery will be found than that set forth in this context. A New Testament mystery is a truth hitherto withheld, or hid in God, but now revealed. The sum total of all the mysteries in the New Testament represents that entire body of added truth found in the New Testament, which is unrevealed in the Old Testament. On the other hand, the New Testament mystery is to be distinguished from the mystery of the cults of Babylon and Rome, whose secrets were revealed and held on penalty of death. For the New Testament mystery, when it is revealed, is to be declared to the ends of the earth, and is restricted only to the extent of the limitation of the natural man. If, for the previous bringing in of other divine purposes of an earthly nature, it were necessary to employ holy men of God, who spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost, how reasonable is the declaration that holy apostles and prophets were used of the Lord for the present bringing in of the revelation of the heavenly purpose? Under these conditions, is anyone justified in the assumption that the New Testament apostles and prophets who spoke forth a later revelation were one with less honored of God as media of divine truth than the sons of God, the holy men of God, who spoke forth the former revelation? Messiah's kingdom occupied the Old Testament prophets' vision. They saw not the mystery of that new man, which bears collectively the name of Christ. True indeed, the Messiah was to die a sacrificial death. This fact had not only been typified, but but it had been solemnly promised in every Jewish sacrifice. On the other hand, little had been revealed about the value that would accrue from his resurrection. On that particular event, being more related to the new creation than to the old, was, to some extent, withheld as a part of the mystery. What then is the mystery? It is stated in verse 6 here in the simplest of terms, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. This declaration must not be treated lightly. That the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body is not a recognition of the Old Testament prediction that during Israel's coming kingdom glory, Gentiles will be raised to a subordinate participation in those covenant blessings. Those predictions were of an earthly calling, and being revealed in very much Old Testament prophecy, could be no part of the heavenly calling, the mystery hidden in God. This mystery is of a present uniting of Jews and Gentiles into one body, a new divine purpose, and therefore in no sense the perpetuation of anything which has been before. That the church is a new purpose of God could not be more clearly stated than it is in verses 3 through 9. Yet certain schools of theology contend that the church in her present form is but a continuation of God's one purpose from the beginning of the human family. They speak of an Old Testament church and seek to relate this to the one body which constitutes the New Testament revelation. The fact that Jews are now invited into fellowship in the one body with Gentiles is no warrant for the belief that Old Testament saints are included in this new divine purpose. Arguments for an Old Testament church are usually based on the fact that the Old Testament sacrifices looked forward to Christ, that Israel was a sanctified nation, that there was a godly remnant in each of Israel's generations, that the Septuagint translates the word which indicates an assembly or gathering of people by the word ekinoia, and that since all saints go to heaven, they must, because of that fact, constitute one company. These arguments are insufficient at every point. In verses 7, 8, and 9, the apostle contends for his unique position as the chosen one of God for the reception and declaration of the new message concerning the mystery of Christ. In verse 10, he declares that it is through the church that the angelic hosts now know the manifold wisdom of God, as in 2:7, the angels are, in the ages to come, to know by the church the exceeding riches of the grace of God. All this disclosure concerning the church and her present ministry to the principalities and powers as a revelation of God's wisdom is likewise according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. It is given to the angelic hosts to observe that through our faith in Christ, Christians have boldness, free intimacy with God, and introduction into his blessed fellowship. But how great is the privilege granted to those who experience this intimacy and fellowship? Chapter 4, which enforces the truth of the one body, opens with the call to all believers to recognize and observe the obligation growing out of the doctrine of this unity which has been created by the Holy Spirit of God, a unity established by seven particulars, namely one body, one spirit, one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father. On the assured principle that the epistles take up and expand the germ truths constituting the substance of Christ's upper room discourse, the early portion of the fourth chapter of Ephesians is evidently an amplification of the petition in Christ's prayer, that they all may be one as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. As this point is the central theme of the next division of this discussion, its consideration is deferred at this time. The diversified contribution which the figure of the head and the body with its many members makes to the doctrine of the church has been noted above, namely that the body of Christ is growing by self-development, that the members render specific service under the direction of the head, and that the body is one in the sense that it is an organism indwelt by one life principle. All right, that ends chapter 4 on page 78. We will pick up chapter 5 on page 79 next time.